It's so such a joy to be in the house of the Lord. Just to give God thanks and praise for his goodness and his awesome grace. It has been another day of God's faithfulness, God's compassion, God's mercy, and God's grace. And we just want to lift him up and praise him and thank him again in everything, acknowledging his hand at work in what we do. The scripture says that except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman wakes but in vain. And it's simply saying if God doesn't do it, you can think you're going to bring it all to pass and everything's going to work. But if God's not watching over it, there is no guarantee it's going to happen. And so we're here acknowledging God's goodness, here acknowledging that God is the one that's keeping us and taking care of us and watching over us. And we just want to give him praise and glory. Amen. Just want to give him praise and glory. So good to see those of you that are here tonight. And it's always a joy. It's always a joy when I'm not here by myself. And so I'm grateful and thankful. Hey, we're going to open our time together in prayer. And then Benny is going to play us some awesome worship music. And then we are going to pray. I know that there are some needs that are represented among us. And there are people that are hurting everywhere, and we're just going to believe God, as we always have. We're just going to believe God to take care of all those things that we're going to bring before him. Sister Alice, would you open us in prayer, please?
Amen. We want to thank you, Heavenly Father. Oh, praise your holy name. Praise you. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We thank you. You kept us from all the hurt, harm, and danger that's going on out there in the highways and the byways in the city. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for just waking us up to see this glorious day that you have created ever since the beginning of time. And you allowed us to be in this beautiful day of your creation. We thank you. Heavenly Father, just ask for your Holy Spirit just to come and sit with us, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, just crown us with more wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, Heavenly Father. We need you, Heavenly Father, in a mighty way, Heavenly Father. Oh, glory to your name, Heavenly Father. Just bless each person that came out this evening, Heavenly Father. If they stand in the need of something, Heavenly Father, we just ask you to reach down and touch them in a mighty way. If anybody who's streaming, Heavenly Father, just touch them, Heavenly Father, just to keep their mind stayed on you, dear Jesus. Heavenly Father, if they need you in a mighty way, we just ask you just to reach down and just wake them and shake them and let them know everything will be okay. If somebody is sitting alone, let them know they're really not alone, but you are with them at all times, Heavenly Father. We thank you for everything that you do for us, Heavenly Father. We thank you. We glorify you. We just ask for your Holy Spirit just to come on in. We invite you in. We need you, Heavenly Father. Just lift us up, Heavenly Father. So open up our mind. If we look like we're getting a little tired, just wake us and shake us, because we need you, Heavenly Father. We thank you for your goodness, your mercy. We just thank you. Take Pastor down in your deep treasures, Heavenly Father. Just let him know that everything is going to be okay, Heavenly Father. Father, we thank you for all your goodness, your mercy, and your love, Heavenly Father. Oh, praise your holy name. Praise your holy name, Heavenly Father. Oh, Heavenly Father, glory, glory, glory. Be there with the ones who's on their way, Heavenly Father. Give them traveling graces, Heavenly Father. In your precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise you. Praise you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
All right, let's get ready to worship. We certainly want to invite all of those of you that are joining us via live stream. We thank God for each and every one of you, and we entrust this night to him. And so we pray that as we worship, you will feel and sense God's awesome presence where you are, wherever you are, and that that presence may bless your life and bring into your very life that which is necessary for you to succeed in every way. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I believe this is your word that you've been waiting for all night. Darwin, where are you? How many know that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all you can? in us.
Hallelujah. How many believe it tonight? Somebody turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, he's able. Tell somebody else, he's able. Y'all ready? Exceedingly, abundantly, above all you could ask for, can, according to the power that worketh in you. He won't give up on you. He's able. How many believe it tonight? Yeah, yeah. He's able. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, y'all. I need y'all to help me sing. God is able to do just what he said. He's gonna fulfill every promise.
He's able.
Say yes, you lead the way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say that this life you gave is not my own. I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on. Lord. Yes, Lord. is yours. Yes to your will. Yes to your every way, Jesus. My life is yours. He wants to take us higher and change us and make us whole. Jesus, trust him with your yes, trust him with your yes tonight. Yes, Lord.
Do you not realize that your life is not your own? That you've been bought with a price? Hallelujah. Therefore, you ought to glorify God in your body and in your spirit, because they are the Lord's. That's what Paul told the Corinthians. Amen. Hallelujah. We are not our own. Our lives belong to Him. Amen. He orders our steps. He is asking us to obey His counsel and His word, that we might be able to accomplish those things that God wants us to accomplish. And that when we make a request of Him, amen, hallelujah, He is going to answer and there will be no delay. Amen. We'll trust Him still. Praise God. Amen. Hey, we're going to take some prayer requests at this time. So if you have a spoken prayer request, we will take that request to heart and we will pray with you concerning that. Donald, I see your hand. Okay, you told us you were going to call him on his birthday. So. Wonderful.
He actually spoke to me. He called my name.
Hey, look at that.
I got more kick. I said, thank you, God.
Amen. Well, that's what you were praying for, that you mentioned last Thursday, that you were going to call him and you were hoping that he would be able to recognize and know who you were.
I got more. It was my birthday. But the Lord is good.
Amen. We're rejoicing with you, man. We know that your request that you were wanting from the Lord was answered and the Lord caused you to rejoice. Amen. What a joy that is, huh? That you thought he might not even recognize your voice. Wow. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Yeah, I would imagine both of you were celebrating. And that is good news. Praise God. Any other requests, prayer requests, or praise reports on your heart or on your mind while you're thinking about it? A friend of mine, as a matter of fact, when I got married, Jeff was one of our groomsmen in our wedding. I went to school with him in Florida. And his wife, Trish, just passed right at the beginning of September, I believe. And she died from complications from COVID. And she was only, no doubt, probably in her late 50s, probably, I think. And they had five daughters and three son-in-laws. So let's remember that family in a very, very special way, but especially Jeff Hogan, who is obviously grieving greatly over the loss of his wife. They have been married approximately 37 to 39 years. I can't remember exactly, but they've been married a long time. And just remember that family, especially Jeff Hogan, okay? My half-sister that lives in Bermuda sent me an email. She has a niece, I believe. Her name is Rabina Fullerton. She's having some severe complications from cystic fibrosis, and she's in the hospital. Let's remember that young lady, Rabina Fullerton, okay? Any other requests? Let's remember our church, that the Lord will continue to help us, lead us, guide us, grant us counsel and wisdom as to what we ought to do and be about, especially during these very difficult times that we're living in. Mother, did you have something? All right, let's remember Mother Oliver's family, and we're going to trust the Lord for those in that family, for the unsaved, for those who just need to know the love of Jesus and the awesome hand of God. Art? Oh, wow. How old was his daughter? Do you know? 24 years of age. Oh, God. Oh, wow. Wow. Jesus. Tell us his name again. Garrett? Or Gary. Gary Jackson. Okay, let's remember Gary Jackson and that family, having discovered that his daughter had been murdered and left in the desert. My heart just aches for that family. Let's remember them in prayer. To lose a loved one, even if they've gone down the wrong path, it's just a tragic thing. Let's remember them in prayer. Anybody else? Any other prayer requests? Okay, let's remember Pastor Leon and Sister Michelle as they travel to Baltimore, that the Lord will be with them and grant them favor, that they won't have to sit on a runway for 4 hours, amen, because of weather delays or anything else. But let's remember them, that the Lord will bless them with safe travel and just have a great time while they're there. Be refreshed and blessed and just come back just excited about serving Jesus. Amen. Let's remember the country, the leaders in the country. There are so many major things afoot that we just need to pray that their hearts will be open to God's counsel and wisdom, and that they might lead us to a place that we can experience some degree of peace. Amen. Let's lift them up and continue to pray for them, that the Lord will lead them and bless them. Okay, if you have an unspoken request, you can raise your hand, signifying that you want the Lord to remember something that's on your heart, and we will take that before the Lord in prayer. Hey, Will, would you pray for us? I'm coming with the mic. You can stay right there. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you, knowing you are our hope, our comforter, our healer, our provider. Lord God, you are all these things and much more, Lord God. Because as we look at our own lives, Lord God, it was you, Lord God, who brought us here. It was you who kept us. It was you, Lord God, who saved us. You've done everything. And we want to thank you in advance for that. Lord God, there's so many requests on people's hearts, Lord God. We start off with our praise report, Lord God. Donald prayed, Lord, and asked specifically to you, Lord God, for something that happened in his brother, Lord God, and you showed up and showed out, Lord God. You do these things, Lord God, to increase our faith in you, Lord God, showing up when we don't know what we should do or even say sometimes, Lord God, but you, Lord God, know what to do to increase our faith. Lord God, we pray for arch friend Gary, Lord God. Lift him up, Lord God. Show him, Lord God, that you are the only comforter that he needs, Lord God, in this time, Lord God. We live in dark times, Lord God. There are evil men doing with evil schemes in this world, Lord God. But as the darkness prevails over this planet, Lord God, the light that you have put in every one of your believers should shine, thus the more brighter, Lord God. We are the light, Lord God. We are the salt of this earth, Lord God. Instill in us your spirit, Lord God, to go out and do what we're called to do, which is be your ambassadors, Lord God. Lord God, we pray. We pray, Lord God, for all the leaders of this country, Lord God. We know, Lord God, who controls the powers of the air, Lord God. And they have submitted their souls apparently to him, Lord God. But we know, Lord God, we come from a different country with a king, Lord God, who has dominion over all the universe, Lord God. Let your power, Lord God, and your strength and might reign throughout this world, Lord God, to reach out, Lord God, and save those, Lord God, who need to be saved, Lord God. Touch those people in their minds, Lord God, to let them know that you are the King. There are no other gods before you, Lord God, and without you, Lord God, they would not even exist. Lord God, let your spirit reign, Lord God, in the church, Lord God. As we move, Lord God, in this craziness, the pandemic, Lord God, the civil unrest, Lord God, the unsureness of where we're going as a country, Lord God, you, Lord God, are the provider. Yes, yes, yes. Let's not lean on our leaders. We need to pray for our leaders, Lord. They are just men, Lord God. They are not God's little G or big G, Lord God, but you, Lord God, are the God, big G, Lord God. So let us rely on you, Lord God. Let your spirit reign in us that we come to you, Lord God, for counsel. Come to you, Lord God, when we have need, Lord God. Lord God, we pray, Lord God, for pastor's friend who lost his wife, Lord God. We're remembering Jeff, Lord God, because we can only imagine in some instances, Lord God, what it's like to lose our best friend. Lord God, there's so many things that we could talk about regarding your best friend, Lord God. But Lord God, show up in Jeff's life. Show up and comfort him, Lord God, and show him you are his best friend. You can get him through this, Lord God. You can get the family through this, Lord God. Because Lord God, you are the ultimate comforter. You know how to fill voids of emptiness, Lord God, miraculously. You are an awesome God. And I know that you hear our prayers because our hearts are in it, Lord God. Our minds are in it, Lord God. We are coming before you humbled in our minds and put away our pride, Lord God. We bow down before you, Lord God, because you know, Lord God, we need you more than breath itself. So we're asking you, Lord God, to go before us, walk alongside us, and gird us up from behind, Lord God, as we walk through this life, Lord God, because we never know, Lord God, what might happen, but you do. And we're relying on your providence, Lord God, to push us through and make us and allow us to see your face one day. We're asking this in the name of Jesus, your son and provider, the King of kings and Lord of lords. Amen and amen.
Amen. Praise him.
Thank you.
Go right ahead and play it, Benny.
Glory, hallelujah.
Thank you.
You see, y'all, still you're searching for someone who would respond. I'm right here. Sit high, still you're looking for somewhere you could abide. I'm right here. I'm the one. You don't have to search no more. I'm the one you're looking for. You call me, I will respond. Yeah, when you call me, I will respond. When you pull me, I will come running to your arms. I will respond to you. You see all,
you see all, still you're searching. You're looking for a place you
call me,
I will respond.
When you call me,
I will respond. When you pull me, I will come running to your arms. I will respond.
When you call me,
I will respond.
When you call me,
I will respond. When you pull me, I will come running to your arms.
I will respond to you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just thinking of all of the people around the world that worship God. Amen. So many different cultures, so many different languages. The gospel is being lived out, and the children of light are coming forth in all of these nations to minister to people. The gospel has already gone around the world, and people in just about every culture, country, and nation have heard the gospel, which is one of those things that the scriptures say the end will not come until this gospel is preached in the whole world. And we are at that time now with the internet and with Facebook and with Twitter and with Critter and everything else. The gospel has gotten out, and people are hearing the word of God. Amen? Hey, the last times that we were together, we were talking about this whole matter the night before last week. We were talking about the whole fact as to why people don't come to church. Okay, we took a look at that. And we did not, I mean, we had a long list, Donald, and we didn't exhaust it. And people have legitimate reasons why they don't come to church. And I can understand why, because of what we have made church to become. Church has become something that a lot of people are just turned off by. And there are just some things that we just don't relate very well to people, and people don't relate to us. And so we were not left with that dilemma, because we recognize that Jesus Christ never intended, come on now, never intended for us to be people that invited people to come to church. That's not what he told us to do. He told us to go. And so we recognize that if people ain't coming, it's because we ain't doing what he told us to do, because we ain't going. And so we took a look at then what it looks like to actually go, and we started to examine how Jesus encountered people. And as you look at Jesus's encounters with people, a number of things become very, very evident almost immediately about Jesus's ministry to people. And one of the things that I noticed very early is that how Jesus ministers to people is a lot different from some of the ways that we have done so over the years. And so there is a disconnect between how we minister to people and how Jesus ministered to people. And so as we go through this, and the title of our theme for the last couple of weeks is Jesus encountering people. Okay, Jesus encountering people. This is what I know, Will, to be true. That if you're out and about, you are going to encounter people. Amen. You can't not encounter people. Absolutely. You know, you're going to encounter people even if you didn't want to.
Say that.
You are somebody's gonna say something to you.
Yeah.
Whether good or bad, you're going to encounter people.
Yes, you will.
Amen. Yes. If you go to a store and you buy something, you're encountering people.
Amen.
If you're in the grocery store standing in a line, you're going to encounter people.
Yes.
If you come up to the cash register,
yes,
you are going to encounter people.
Yes.
If you're just out and about,
yes,
you are going to encounter people. So the first thing that we see, Donald, with Jesus is that Jesus was out and about.
Yes, he was.
He was out and about. Amen. So the thing that we have to grab from Jesus's example, and it's no different then as it is today, he encountered people by going out where people were. And if we went out where people were, we would encounter people. And now we have to take a look at, once we go out, how we conduct ourselves in relating to and ministering to people in order to have a positive impact in their lives. So last week we talked about the fact that Jesus encountered a leper. Okay? We took a look at what that looked like. Now, this is Jesus encountering a person that was somebody in the community that the community did not want to encounter. And when we go out there, we're going to find some people that when we encounter them, that nobody in the community really wants to encounter them. The homeless community is like that. Nobody really wants to encounter them. We want to ignore them. We want to push them into places and areas where we don't see them. These are people that, to me, are probably as close to lepers as you can get. People just don't want to have anything to do with them. Okay? And so how does Jesus, we took a look at that, how does Jesus encounter people that are like that? That people that nobody else, you remember now, he's coming down off of the mount and he's encountering, he's just taught in these three chapters, chapter 5, 6, and 7. He's taught the Sermon on the Mount and now he's coming down from the mountain and he encounters a leper. And many of the people are following him. The Bible says many people followed him when he came down from the mountain. And this leper sees him coming and he comes toward him and he cries out to him for help. And Jesus is going to encounter the leper. And I said last week that as he moved toward the leper, the crowd moved back away from the leper, because that's what people do when they encounter people that they don't want to encounter. While Jesus is moving toward him, the people are moving away from him because they recognize that they could be contaminated by what he had. And Jesus was not fearful of being contaminated. And this is one of the things that we have to understand, that if we're going to go out in the community, we are going to encounter some people that could possibly contaminate other people. So how do we deal with people that can contaminate other people? How did Jesus deal with him? See, this is what we have to understand. If we are people doing God's work, if we are people empowered by the Holy Spirit and God gives us an opportunity to encounter a person, we have to believe that God will protect us.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. If we're going out there afraid of every little stone we turn over, we're never going to do ministry. We're always going to be trying to protect ourselves and keep ourselves. We can't keep ourselves. That's his job. His job is to keep us and to protect us. Our job is to minister to people in faith, believing that God is going to take care of us. And so Jesus did the unthinkable, Will. He touched him. Jesus didn't have to. I want you to see that. He did not have to touch the leper. He could have just spoken a word and healed the leper. But I ask the question, what impact would the touch have had on the leper? I mean, think about that for just a moment. Nobody even wanted to be close to him.
Right.
And Jesus reached out and touched him. Now, that had to do something to the leper, that this person would actually touch him when nobody else would even want to come close. I said last week that when people took food to a leper, they took the food and they rested it down and then walked away. And then the leper came and got the food. They did not want, they would be compassionate and try to help the leper and serve the leper food, but they would not come in contact with the leper. But Jesus, in front of a multitude of people, touched a leper. Now watch this. In Old Testament times, if you came in contact with a leper in any form, if you sat down on a seat that a leper sat on, you were unclean for the rest of the day until you washed, appeared before the priest, and they declared you to be clean again. Jesus wasn't even concerned about that. Trusting that if he touched him, God would protect him and he would not be contaminated by this leprosy. He's encountering people that are untouchables and he touches them. Because his desire is to see them whole.
Amen. That's right.
At the expense of us being contaminated, we are reaching out for this person, not thinking selfishly, but thinking for the person's healing and wholeness. Can we believe God enough to do that? Is that reckless or irresponsible? That's the question you have to ask. Is it reckless or irresponsible to touch somebody that's contaminated, believing that if you're doing something for somebody else, for the glory of God, that God would protect you? That's a serious question. It's a serious question because we're there right now with people that are contaminated with COVID-19. And we can make a decision that we are not going to minister to them. And if we do, we got to minister from a long way away. What would Jesus do? I think Jesus would go right up unmasked and lay hands on these people and minister to them, trusting God to protect him. Because if he would do it for a leper, which in that day, there was no disease more contagious than leprosy. Yes. No more debilitating than leprosy. As a matter of fact, one of one of the things that happens in leprosy is that leprosy deadens your ability to feel pain. Okay? So when you see a leper or hear about a leper or see a leper in ancient times and the fingers are just sort of missing, it is not that they rotted off. It's that the leper was using his hand to do things and never felt pain and wore his fingers away because they don't feel pain. Once leprosy gets to a certain state, they will do things and try things and actually operate in a way because they feel no pain. They actually wear fingers away, toes away, and any other thing that they are working with and working on and they don't feel the pain. They're actually losing parts of their fingers through it because leprosy does that to your nervous system. And Jesus, knowing that if he ever caught leprosy, it could happen to him, did not care. Right. Did not matter to him because he fully trusted God that God would protect him. Mm-hmm. Wow.
When I was this afternoon, when we were working Sunday in Santa Monica, there was a gentleman, a homeless gentleman, and he was walking toward me. I didn't feel nervous or scared. He asked to use my phone. My mind was thinking, and the first thing that came to my mind was our lesson from last week.
Yes.
And I said yes to him, and he used my phone. He called his mom, and I didn't feel scared of him. I felt like it was, I don't like to use the word test, but I felt like listening to this, I was put in a position, am I trusting?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Once I shared my phone with him, and he said thank you, he was very obliged,
I felt relieved because I was obedient to my spirit.
Amen. Amen.
And so I can line up with.
Yeah, we can let fear lead us, influence us, and impact us, or we can live above that fear.
Yes.
And trust that God is going to take care of us. I think if we're doing ministry, we're in the hands of God. He is pleased that we're doing ministry and has an obligation to take care of us. Now, if our time and mission is over, we checking out of here. But if our mission is not over yet, I got to believe that God is going to take care of us. Now, if you out there doing something reckless, crazy and stupid for yourself, God's not obligated to watch over you and protect you. But if you're doing that which he has commanded you to do and you're obeying what he told you to do, I believe that he will protect you. And Jesus, we often say Jesus is our example until Jesus does something that we feel like, wait a minute, hold up. Yeah. I don't really want to be like him in that. No, we want to be like Jesus in every way. Jesus never operated in fear. And if you learn anything from him encountering a leper, you got to understand that he never operated out of fear. He never let fear push him to do something against what God had commanded him to do. He went fearlessly into crowds and ministered to people.
Yes.
Amen. That's what we took a look at in relationship to the leper. Mm-hmm. And we had mentioned that the leper knew him. And we asked the question last week, how many people know you outside of the church? How many people actually know you outside of church life? And I'm not just talking about just on the job. I'm talking about beyond the job. How many people in your community actually know you? And if they don't, it's probably because you're not out and about. You stay in the safe confines of church and family, and you're not really like Jesus out there touching people, ministering to people. And then we talked about Jesus encountering a blind man. And how he ministered to this blind man, you know, the story, the blind man's crying out, "Oh, son of David, have mercy on me." And the crowd hushes him and says to him, you know, this is not the proper decorum. Hold your peace. And he kept on crying. The Bible said he cried out even louder the second time and ignored the crowd. And Jesus just stopped, stood, turned, and beckoned for them to bring the blind man to him. The people that nobody else is interesting, that he's blind, but the people don't want to see him. Isn't that something? They don't want to see him. But Jesus hears his heart's cry and beckons him to be brought, and Jesus ministers to him and helps him. Now, these stories, these encounters, and this is the second thing I want you to get from these encounters. Jesus does not reject or refuse any of these people in what their request is. That's the thing that blows my mind. Even the woman, and we're going to deal with her in just a moment, the Syrophoenician woman, who is a foreigner. It seems like Jesus is rejecting her request, but even Jesus goes beyond and does for her what she asks. And so let's take a look at that. He heals this blind man. And again, the people knew who Jesus was. The blind man asked and inquired. And when he heard that it was Jesus, he had heard before what Jesus was doing for everybody else. Now he wanted Jesus to do something for him. So the people had heard of Jesus. They knew about Jesus. And that's what caused us to ask the question, how many people know about us outside of the church? Are we out and about like Jesus is out and about? Okay, so now we're in Mark chapter 7, verse 24 through 30, and this is the story of the Syrophoenician woman. She was a woman that was a foreigner, okay? So Jesus had left the confines of Israel proper and has traveled north to the area of Tyre and Sidon, okay? And so in verse 24, it says, "And from there he arose and went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon and entered into a house and would have no man know it." but he could not be hid. That's a great statement. He could not be hid. He had been out and about so much now, impacting so many people, that he could not even hide. If anybody got a whisper that he was somewhere in town, the word spread faster than your text message could. And people started coming to the house that he was at, even though he wasn't in his own area, in his own country, in either in Jerusalem or in Nazareth or in Galilee. He could not be hid way up at the northern tip of Israel. And this woman comes in verse 25, for a certain woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard of him and came and fell at his feet. Now listen to that. She heard of him. That means people were talking about him all over the place, not only in Israel, but outside of Israel. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation. She was a foreigner. And she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. But Jesus said unto her, let the children first be filled. And the children are the children of Israel. Remember that Jesus has been commissioned by God to go only to the children of Israel and minister to them. And he would come and minister to them first, because that's who God has sent him to. So he says, let the children first be filled, for it is not fitting to take the children's bread and to cast it unto the dogs. And he's not saying anything derogatory about her or her nation. He's saying that this is just what is proper in the household. The children are fed, and then the animals are fed later. This is just the proper protocol. This is how things are. And he's saying this, and the woman says to him, and she answered and said unto him, yes, Lord. Yet the dogs under the table eat of the children's crumbs. And he said unto her, for this saying, go your way, the devil is going out of your daughter. Meaning that he is impacted by her faith. He is impacted by her heart's cry. And because of her heart's cry and her faith in him, he could not reject her, even though he did not come initially to minister to people outside of Israel. And even though he had been commissioned to minister to Israelites, this woman, he just couldn't turn her away. He just could not turn her away. As a matter of fact, in one of the other gospels, this woman is pursuing him, and his disciples are saying, Lord, please send this woman away. She just won't give up. She just keeps on pressing on to try to get you to do what she wants you to do. Send this woman away. They recognize she's a foreigner. But Jesus' heart of compassion, when he encounters people, when they just believe him, and when they just continue to cry after him, he cannot turn them down. One, he could not be hid. Two, she heard of him because he was out and about. You are not going to be heard about at home.
No, you won't.
Amen. If you're not out and about and you're just stuck in your home, your family will know about you. Maybe even your neighbor might know about you, but you are not going to be known apart from your house and the places you hang out. We have to be out and about. And so he honors her request, even though she is not a daughter of Israel. Number four is Jesus encounters a rich young ruler. One of the things, mother, that I want you to see is that when you're out and about, you are going to encounter a lot of different people.
That's right.
From all stages of life.
That's right.
And you're going to encounter rich people. You are going to encounter poor people, and more poor people than rich people, because there are more poor people than rich people. We're going to encounter people from every spectrum of society. And we have to be like Jesus in the way we minister to people. So let's listen to the story now from Mark chapter 10, beginning at verse 17. And this story appears also in one or two of the other gospels. And when he was going forth into the way, that is Jesus, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, good master. Now notice that. Why is he calling him good master? Because he's heard of him and knows things about him because he's out and about. Notice that when people come to Jesus, they already know who he is. That's why they're coming. Okay? So he says, good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why do you call me good? There is none good but one, that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Defraud not. Honor thy father and mother. And he answered and said unto him, master, all these have I observed from my youth. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. Stop there for just a moment. Underline that part of the verse where it says, then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. He's rich, and Jesus loved him. Not because he was rich. Mm-hmm. Jesus would have loved him if he was poor. The thing that I'm trying to convey to you is when Jesus is out and about ministering to people, he's doing it because he loves them. We cannot go out with this mindset that we are going to guilt people into getting saved. That was not Jesus's way. Jesus went out among lost people and ministered to them and made them feel like he cared for them because he genuinely did. And if we miss this trait, this character trait in Jesus, then we have missed it altogether. Jesus did what he did because he genuinely loved people, and it did not matter what corner of life they were coming from. So whether it's a foreigner like the Syrophoenician woman, if it's a blind man like blind Bartimaeus, if it's a leper, he comes and he does what he does because he genuinely loves people and he wants to see people healed. He wants to see people saved. He wants to see people established in the kingdom. He genuinely desires that. And so here we have Jesus encountering a rich young ruler, and the Bible says that first of all, this young man recognized him or knew him or knew about him. And Jesus took the time to listen to his question and his request and answer it. Now you got to remember, there's thousands of people around, and God has a particular heart for the poor and the disadvantaged. And Jesus is taking time with a rich person. And the other poor people are saying, wait a minute. Why are you taking time with him? He's already got all that he needs to have. Jesus takes the time with him because when a person inquires, he values them enough to take time to minister to them. That's why he's out and about. He's out and about to minister to every person that shows any kind of interest at all. Okay? And so he says one thing. This is in verse 21. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, one thing you lack. Go your way, sell whatsoever you have and give to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven. And come, take up your cross and follow me. And so Jesus very lovingly and very compassionately helps him to understand a major issue in his life. And that is a dependence on his wealth. And so Jesus is saying, what I want to do for you is I want to take away that stumbling block. And I want to help you and guide you and lead you into what you ought to do in order to be free from that which really has you in bondage. The young man is finding this hard to do. So the Bible says he went away sorrowful in one of the other gospels because he was rich. And it says here in verse 22, and he was sad at that saying and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And so Jesus offers something to him and compassionately tries to help him to see what's hindering him. He answers his question. He said, what else should I or must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus tells him. He gives him free counsel. And the man will not receive it. All right? So again, even with the people that won't receive it, Jesus is still compassionate, still loving, still willing to help. And some people just do not receive it. Okay? Let's go on to the next one, and this will be the last one that we'll talk about tonight. Number five, Jesus encounters Will, a chief tax collector. A chief tax collector, or a chief sinner. All right. So Jesus is dealing again. He's dealing with all kinds of people, Donald. He's not coming upon some people and refusing to deal with them because they're really bad sinners. Such were some of us. and we've been transformed from bad sinners into kingdom children. So if he was elective and selective and decided that there are some sinners that are just too bad to redeem, some of us would have never made it.
That's right. Amen.
Paul claimed that he was chief of sinners because he persecuted the church. And he said, by the grace of God, God decided to save me. God didn't save you because you're a good person. He saved you because of his grace. Amen. He's merciful. Let's take a look at Luke 19, 1 through 10. This is the story, Donald, of Zacchaeus. He's a chief tax collector. So if he's a chief tax collector, he is among, Donald, the most hated in his community. Because he's working for the Roman oppressors who are oppressing Israel and demanding taxes to be paid that Israelites, you know, were never paying before. So the Roman government, who is now in control of Palestine or Israel, is demanding that these people pay taxes. And the Roman government is hiring Jews, their own people, to collect these taxes. And these tax collectors are taking more money than they should be. Come on, Clarence. They're taking more money from the people than the Roman government is requiring. So they're robbing people. That's why they're so hated, because the people know that they're robbing them. Okay? So let's read the story. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans. The publican is a tax collector, and he was rich. How did he get rich? He got rich by robbing people or taking more taxes than he should have been taking. As a matter of fact, as a chief tax collector, he would have had other tax collectors under him. It's just like, you know, in the United States, you first of all, you work your business by yourself and you grow your business, and then you get people employed that's under you, and you're making money off of them as they're doing their work. So if he's a carpenter and he's within your company, you are charging the consumer $70 an hour and you're paying him $30. Yeah. Yeah. That's what tax collectors did. They hired a number of tax collectors, sent them out to collect taxes more than the Roman government required. They paid Rome the money that they required, and now the chief tax collector doled out some money to the tax collectors and made money off of each one of the tax collectors. That's how he got rich. Got rich by taking more money from the people than should have been taken. Okay, you got the picture?
Yeah.
So Zacchaeus was chief among the publicans, and he was rich. Verse 3. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was. Why? Why did he seek to see Jesus, who he was? The answer is simple.
Because he was amongst
They knew that he was amongst the people.
All right. He had heard. Because Jesus was out and about doing what he was doing. He had heard about him, but never saw him. Yeah. Now he's hearing that he's in our town, and he's going to pass by this way. But I'm a short guy, and I can't see over the crowd. So he runs ahead, climbs up a tree, because he knew that Jesus had to come through that way so that he could see him, because he had heard about him. Question looms again. Who has heard of us that they would want to see us? Amen. I said last week, Will, this is what I said. Had Jesus never performed a single miracle, he would have still been just about as influential in Israel because of all of the things that he was doing just to minister to people and show them that he loved them. He would have still been well known without performing a single miracle. So it says here in verse 3, and he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because there were so many people there, couldn't push his way through the crowd. Now think about this, and this is another part of it, okay? He knew, watch this. There were a lot of people that were lining the streets, and the crowd was thick. He knew he was really hated by everybody. For him to push through the crowd, he might have gotten beaten to death. So he decided, I'm not going to try to push through the crowd. I'm going to run around the crowd and climb a tree. I don't want to have to deal with all these angry people that I'm taking money from. So he runs ahead and climbs up a tree. The Bible says because he was little of stature, he couldn't see who Jesus was by staying behind the crowd. Verse 4, and he ran before, climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him. For he was to pass that way. Verse 5. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw Zacchaeus and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at your house. Now, Alice, there's a problem here. Okay? Sister Porter, there is a problem here. Watch this. Everybody knew who Jesus was. Everybody knew who Zacchaeus was.
That's right.
The one was loved and the other was hated. Now they're trying to figure out, why would Jesus, who is so different from Zacchaeus, want to hang out at Zacchaeus' house? Zacchaeus wanted to see him, who he was. Jesus wanted to see him so he can become something other than he was. Jesus wasn't trying to avoid him. Jesus wasn't trying to make sure his reputation was intact by not hanging out with somebody like Zacchaeus. He literally invited himself to Zacchaeus's house.
Yes, he did. Yes.
To minister to a person that was hated by everybody in the community.
Yes.
Knowing that his association with Zacchaeus could damage his reputation. Watch this. Mother, the salvation of Zacchaeus to Jesus was more important than what people thought about his reputation. And until we get over our reputation issues, we are going to avoid some people. And Jesus did not avoid anyone. He would minister to every single person that he had an opportunity to minister to. And we see the broad gamut of these people, from a rich young ruler all the way down to a leper and everybody in between. Jesus is ministering to them because that's why he's out and about.
Right.
Sister Porter? Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Because nobody has to be around, but if we think we're better than somebody else, or that our issue isn't just like somebody else's issue, just in a different ground, then that too will keep us from putting that
Yeah, yeah, that darkness, you're right. That darkness that seems to hide within us comes out every once in a while in that manner. Like we feel better than this person, and so we avoid them. That darkness that he has to root out of us to make us more like his son. Go ahead. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. And so, yeah, you're right. We're still a work in progress, aren't we? I guess what we take from this is that with Jesus, there is no person that is not special. No matter how much they may be hated, even in their community, to him, they are special. Kim? Yeah. 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 Yeah.
I don't want to talk to you. I don't want nobody to even think I'm associated with you.
Sure.
They're going to think that I'm okay with your day.
Yeah.
That's not, yeah. That. Yeah. Not for me. But it's like, because the Lord has told me a couple of times with a few different stats, like, no, even though you may have been right on what you said to them, or how
I did. Okay. Yeah, yeah. Sure.
And I was just one of those, is that just something I'm thinking? The Lord didn't say that.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Something like, it just came to my mind. Clearly, the devil don't have to fall out.
That's true. That's true. That's true.
You have to be like,
yeah.
That, you know, you know,
yes,
know.
Yes. Sure, sure. All of us do, you know.
Thank God that I was smart enough to say, you know what? You better be breathing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's too much that just couldn't happen.
Sure, sure.
I say, number one, I don't want this man's blood on my
hands. Yeah, start. Yeah.
Number two, this could be a, for lack of a better phrase, a drop of the bucket of him going the way of Christ, and it just happened to be.
Yeah, that's what you have to see.
And I'm just like, okay.
Yeah.
So a friend of mine came with me, because I was talking to her about it, and she was like, girl, you know you're going to be obedient to the Lord, because she's going to be good with it.
Sure.
So I said, okay. And she said, well, I'll come with you because we both know he's shaped. And he'll take what I may say, turn it around, and walk to the supervisor.
Okay,
like,
okay.
I'm trying to convert him.
Yeah. Sure, sure, sure. Yeah.
And I already knew from a prior conversation that he was leaning toward being a Jehovah's Witness.
Okay.
So I knew he would use all that against me because apparently he don't want to go to Jehovah's
Witness. Wow, wow.
And so I said, okay, so she said, well, I'll go, but I'm going to hang back.
Mm.
Just so if something was to come about, I could say, I was there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Praise God. Yeah. Yeah.
And I just knew it. And as sure as you, before I left work that next day, because you know we live there, the Lord was like, yeah, you're going to be that again.
You just went through the motions on that one, huh?
I said, okay, Lord, if this is you, which I already knew, create an opportunity.
Praise God.
Which he did. I was sitting in the office by myself. Mm-hmm.
Just come.
Yeah. Praise God. Amen. Yeah.
Like, I'm making it known, this is not for me.
Yeah.
But I said, that was inappropriate and it was uncalled for. And for that, I'm sorry.
Praise God.
I'm one of those people who
praise God.
Apologize
yeah.
For
yeah.
Life.
Yeah.
But I was like, I'm sorry. And I said, you know what? For this, that, and the other, that, and
that's important. That's important. What's important is that we see ourselves for who we are and in the areas where we are not quite like Jesus. And God brings it to our attention that in this area, you're not being like Jesus. And we have to be men and women enough to agree with him. Because if we can't agree with him, then change cannot happen. We have to see people that are lost people as precious. And treat them like Jesus treated them. Not turn them down, not turn them away, not scorn them, not deal with them badly. We must treat them with love and help them to know that God sees them as precious. And by the way we treat them, we can communicate that to them, that they are indeed precious people. Okay?
Amen.
Let's go on a little further then. Here we go in the story. So he runs up in the tree. Jesus comes by that way and gives him a personal invitation. The personal invitation is Jesus inviting himself to Zacchaeus' house. And the Bible says in verse 6, he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. Now let's stop there for just a second. Because the question that we have to grapple with is how do hated people receive us? How do people that are different from us receive us? How do people that think you don't like me receive us? This person, hated by everybody in the community that knew him, received Jesus joyfully. Wow. Can you imagine how many people were looking at him out of the side of there?
Yeah.
You know, soon as they saw Zacchaeus coming, you could see the hate look, the hate stare. You know, everybody just despised this guy. And no doubt wanted to jump him because he was small. You know, the women probably thought they could take Zacchaeus, and probably some of them wanted to jump him. But notice this, it is in the way that you deal with people that will determine how they receive you.
Amen.
Jesus did not say, hey, Zacchaeus, you done robbed everybody in the town. You know what I mean? He's assigning him to hell, not even having known him. No, he gives himself an invitation to come and be with this man when everybody else hated him. Jesus wanted to spend time with him. And I would imagine that Zacchaeus probably thinking, man, you know, the only folk that I'm having dinner with is tax collectors. Nobody else in the town wants to sit with me and eat with me. But here's a guy that everybody adores,
yes,
and he wants to come to my house and dine with me.
Yes.
And he comes down quickly, and he's happy that Jesus wants to receive him. Yeah. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Because the Bible does say that he stands at the door and knocks. So that must mean that he's invited himself to our house as well. He's standing at our door knocking. He's inviting himself in. And now we got to make a decision as to whether we're going to open the door.
Absolutely.
Isn't that something?
Absolutely.
So the question then is, how do people receive us? Are they receiving us and thinking, you know, I just want to get this guy out of my life, so I'm just going to let him in for a minute? Or do they open the door wide because of how you've shown interest in them? Will? Yeah.
We hate sin.
Yes.
What happens there is that by changing that narrative, we have to let the reputation of us being like Jesus precede us. This is why Zacchaeus would have come to Jesus.
Because he had heard.
He had heard how good he was
to other people. Yeah. Yeah.
Not just the people that were like him.
That's right. That's right.
Everybody.
Yeah.
What happens is that we become very much like the world. We have our cliques.
Sure. Sure. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's an important question. What might he have heard about Jesus that would have been relative to his own situation? He hung out with tax collectors and sinners, and he ate with them and drank with them. I don't want to say what he drank. You know, the Bible just says he ate and drank with them. I don't know what he drank, but he ate and drank with them. He hung out with tax collectors and sinners. And so when Zacchaeus heard he was in town, he no doubt had heard that this guy hung out with tax collectors and sinners. I want to see who this guy is. And yeah, yeah. Sure. Sure, it is. It is. I mean, yeah, you figuring like if he hung out with tax collectors and sinners, I got a chance here.
Absolutely.
No matter how bad I am, I got a chance here because he's already proven he will hang out with people like me.
Absolutely.
That's funny because just like before, I was saying, we have these things in us that don't allow us to be more like Jesus.
Yeah.
Jesus was the Son of God and was God and you.
Yes, yes. And would hang out, with sinners. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We acting like we more holy than Jesus. Lord, help us. So look at this now in verse 6, and he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. Verse 7, and when they, that's the multitude or the crowd that had gathered, saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was going to be guest with a man that is a sinner. You know what they didn't understand? That was the reason he came. That was his whole mission, was to save sinners. So if he came to save sinners, why would he not be the guest of a sinner? All of them are sinners.
Absolutely.
And he would be a guest at their house too if they would invite him in.
Yeah.
And so the people they're just a little upset that he is going. I mean, they're probably thinking, I've got to be at least 100% better than Zacchaeus morally. Why would he come to my house? You know what I mean? See what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
But what might this do? What might this do to other people that are sinners? Because Paul mentions this as well, even in his own life. What might this do? Let me just throw that out and see what you say. What might this do in the minds, or what might Jesus intend for this to do in the minds of other sinners? That's what it was supposed to do.
Like, I have a chance.
Also, I think it was, maybe they thought, you can work with them because we can't.
Yeah, 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 that's true. Yeah, better you deal with him than us because we'd kill him. But think about that, because Paul said the same thing. Paul said God had saved him mercifully and used him as an example so that other people would come to understand that if he would save somebody like me that persecuted the church, man, can you imagine what he would do for everybody else? I'm thinking if he would do this for Zacchaeus, other people are thinking if he would hang out with a guy like that, I got a chance here. I'm not nearly as bad as Zacchaeus. Surely he would offer an invitation for me to come into the kingdom if he would offer it to Zacchaeus. That's what it's intended to do. So he picks out the worst and most hated guy in the community and ministers to him to give everybody else a hope and a prayer that it can happen for them. Amen. Verse 8. Sure.
Like, okay, you already, we all know, you feel like you better than this dude.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yep.
But it's like, hold on. Right. You're not better than nobody because y'all pretty much on the same page as far as I'm concerned.
Sure. Yeah, we're all sinners. Right. We're all sinners. That's.
You need to stop hating on him.
Yeah.
Because you need to get better too.
Sure. Sure. I mean, this is an incredible story with an incredible lesson for us as believers and how we deal with people that we have to see that the people that we or others see as the worst people in the community are people that are precious to Jesus. Okay? The leper. Who was absolutely despised, rejected, and isolated, almost an exile from the community, Jesus comes and ministers to him. Syrophoenician woman that is not even an Israelite, that Israelites despise the Gentiles, Jesus ministers to her. Now we have a person that is a tax collector, most hated in the community, more hated than the leper, more hated than the Syrophoenician woman, and Jesus ministers to him. They are all precious to him. As he goes out and about and meets all of these people, he proves again that these people are precious to him. And the Bible says, and Zacchaeus stood, and this is in verse 8, and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. Now, when he says this, I want you to get this, Clarence. He is not saying that this is what he does. He's saying this is what I will do. Because you've brought the kingdom to my home, because you're ministering to me, I feel so convicted that now I want you to know because of the transformation that's happening in me, I'm going to give half of what I have to the poor. And if I have taken anything through deception or means that is not proper, I am going to restore fourfold. Isn't that something? It has so impacted his life that Jesus would take interest in him and actually invite himself as a holy man to his house to minister to him. He is coming under conviction and transformation is happening in him. And now he's willing to repent of what he did and restore to people what he took from them. Wow. This is what he says here. Jesus said unto him in verse 9, this day is salvation come to this house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham. Watch this. No matter how bad he became, Jesus still referred to him as a son of Abraham or as a descendant of Abraham. That is a person that is a beneficiary of God's love and God's kingdom. And Jesus is seeking people out to minister to them, to bring them into the kingdom because God intended for them to have the kingdom of God expressed to them and made available to them. They are precious to him. They are precious to him. Okay? For the Son of Man, this is how he ends the story. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. We are an extension of his ministry, and so we are in the world, Alice, to seek and to bring to salvation those that are lost. When we're out and about, that's what we're out and about for. Clarence, we're not out and about to window shop. We're out and about to win the lost. The church cannot forget its agenda, its commission, and the commandment that God has given to us. We have to, one, be out and about. But not just out and about. A lot of people are out and about, but they're not about anything. We have to be about what God would have us to be about, and that is to work for the salvation of the lost. And do it with the kind of compassion and the kind of heart that Jesus did it with, so that people, watch this again, Donald, so that people would receive us joyfully. We have been bearers of bad news for so long. Man, you're going to hell if you keep smoking. What are we doing? We're signing people to hell before we even have them think about heaven. Let's tell them about how they can get to heaven. And then after we have brought all the good news, if they reject it, we might tell them, you know, if you reject this good news, I got to let you know what's going to happen to you. That's okay, but start off with the good news. I told you before that Jesus went about doing good and preaching the glad tidings of the kingdom. Do we know what the glad tidings of the kingdom is? And are we actually sharing the glad tidings, or are we gloom and doom? And people, when they see us coming, are running the other way. When they saw Jesus coming, they received him joyfully. Okay? They received him joyfully. That's why he had thousands of people thronging him all the time. Some people couldn't even get to him because the people surrounded the house. They had to climb up on the roof and tear up the roof and come down through the roof. That's how many people were pressing on him all the time. When the woman that had the issue of blood touched his garment, Jesus turned to his disciples and said, "Who touched me?" And the disciples said, "Man, what are you talking about? All these people pressing against us, pushing us, rubbing against us, and you talking about who touched you?" And Jesus said, "I felt virtue go out of my body. Somebody touched me for real." Meaning that somebody touched me believing for healing, and I felt it go out of my body. Somebody touched me for real. How are we being received? Alice, go right ahead.
This is what we're going through now. This is a great time to witness and bring.
It is. It is.
So many people are hurting. So many people are going through so many different transitions.
Yeah.
They're totally confused. There's a lot of mental illness out there. So when we are out and about in our marks and so forth, if we just say, "Good morning, how are you doing?" and start a conversation, if you go back to that store, you know, a little about
sure,
you,
sure.
You're going to leave little care.
Absolutely.
Until they trust you and you have a full conversation.
Sure.
Because just going out and saying, "How are you doing this morning? How is your day unfolding?"
Sure.
I hear all kind of stuff.
Sure.
Yeah, so this is a great time.
It is. It is. I mean, think about it for just a moment. I'll close with this. Think about it for just a moment. Start to establish a list of things that the gospel supports that's good news, and memorize it. Get it in your spirit. Because if you start to share with people the good news of the gospel and what the gospel is really about, who's going to reject that and say, "Man, get out of my face"? Somebody might, but it wouldn't be because you told them they're going to hell. You know, if one of the things that evangelists used to do, Will, a long time ago, and when I was, you know, first starting in the church, one of their approaches, Mother, was this: "If you were to die today, do you know where you would go?" First of all, dying today is not good news.
No, it's not.
You know what I mean? I don't want to start my day thinking about dying today. That's not good news. As a matter of fact, Jesus never used that approach.
No, he did not.
Paul never used that approach. He shared with them the good news of the kingdom of God. He told them to repent, and this is the reason why he told them. Repent, because the kingdom of God is at hand, or that which the Old Testament prophets spoke about is right before you, and you want to be able to be in the right position to receive it. That's good news. That's not bad news. That's good news that something is here and available to you, and you don't want to miss it. Think about all of the great things of the gospel first. Get it in your spirit and then share it with people. I mean, start, man, listen, I want to share something with you that is just incredibly awesome. God, I mean, radically changed my life. And I want to share with you how he can give you a new life and forgive you for all of your sins. I mean, who would not want that? That's where you start. That's good news. That's good news. If you were to die today. Yeah, yeah. I mean, if we told our story and shared our testimony and helped people to understand that if he would do it for me, and he's done it for millions of people around the world, he can do it for you. And you would have a new life and a new beginning and have a relationship with God.
Amen.
Man, that's incredible. You're talking about a person going home and thinking about that? If you put it in that fashion, they'll think about that. But if you come the wrong way and they don't receive you joyfully, they're going home hating you, hoping they never see you again. Now, even the truth is that even if you share good news, some people will hate you anyway. They're just haters. But the average person would think about what you shared and it'll be on their hearts for a while. And then God, who brings the increase, will do what he does.
Amen.
In their hearts. I hope you'll receive this word tonight and that you'll begin to see how Jesus encounters people and the awesome things that he does, even for the least of these people, he's willing to do because they are precious in his sight.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. Thank you because you're good.
Yes.
Thank you because you've graciously ministered to us and brought us into your family. There's just a ton of good news in all of this that we can share with others, that they will come to know you and know your awesome power, your awesome gifts, your awesome spirit, your awesome son. We just ask God that you'll help us so that we will see more clearly who we ought to be as we follow Jesus as he encounters people. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 We're going to receive our offering. Mother is here, and she will receive it so you can come to where she is. I don't want to have her run around looking for you. Let her relax and let her receive your offering. Amen. Yeah, let her relax and let her receive your offering.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't know that we have any announcements. I don't think we do. But let's continue to serve and honor the Lord and trust God for everything that we stand in need of. He is faithful, loving, and compassionate. Yeah. There are dinners out there that Blessed Family have left over from their senior feeding day, and they've left them on the piano out there. And so if you want a meal, you can take them. If after everybody else has taken a meal and there's still some left, you can take another one if you want to, and eat for at least 6 days. Okay? Amen. Just remember, though, you're not going to get any taller. So, if you're eating meals to try to get taller, those days are gone. You are going to get wider.
Absolutely.
All right, we're dismissed in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I will hope to see you Sunday. Well, we will trust the Lord for his word to minister to people's lives.